All right, thank you for joining us this afternoon. We will begin with introductory remarks from Ron Flagg. Ron?
Hello and welcome to this second installment of a multi-part forum assisting parties in federal agency adjudication, co-hosted by the Administrative Conference of the United States and the Legal Services Corporation. I'm Ron Flagg, president of LSC. LSC is the largest funder of civil legal aid for low-income Americans. We make grants to 132 independent nonprofit legal aid organizations that operate over 900 offices serving all 50 states, U.S. territories, and the District of Columbia. I want to thank our many grantees joining today's program for everything you do to reduce the obstacles that stand in the way of Americans resolving their everyday justice issues. If you registered for this webinar, which you did, obviously, you are aware that too many people go it alone without legal representation in disputes where they risk losing their jobs, their livelihood, their homes, or their children, or seek a restraining order against an abuser. LSC regularly measures the justice gap, the difference between the civil legal needs of low-income Americans and the resources available to meet those needs. Our most recent justice gap study, which was released in 2022, revealed that low-income Americans did not receive any or enough legal assistance in 92% of their substantial legal problems. Now, LSC grantees work every day to narrow the justice gap by providing a wide range of free civil legal services, including eviction defense, protection from predatory lenders, and pertinent to today's discussion, assistance with applications for or appeals involving life-changing and sustaining benefits like SSI, nutrition assistance, and worker compensation. These programs are administered by state and federal agencies, and they involve applications and appeals processes that are designed to be understood and independently navigated by individual people seeking benefits. But the fact is that the processes can be complex, and many individuals need help navigating them. That assistance includes making sure individuals understand what the process is and how benefits eligibility is determined, and helping to develop strong records both for the initial determination and any appeals. Today's installment of our webinar series with ACUS, Promoting Effective Representation, will explore what effectiveness looks like in practice and what counts as positive outcomes in administrative proceedings. Our guest speakers will share best practices for training staff and pro bono attorneys to assist low-income clients with applications for federal benefits or appeals when benefits are denied. They will also discuss federal agency initiatives that provide training and professional development opportunities to help less experienced attorneys and advocates represent their clients most effectively. Our speakers today bring experience from four distinct federal administrative processes: patent appeals, immigration, student loan debt, and disability benefits. Now, these may seem like an eclectic collection of programs for a webinar series on increasing access to justice, but there's a common thread connecting them all. Access to justice, regardless of the setting, means that parties have a full and fair opportunity to make their cases. It means that a person who cannot work because of a disability and needs income support is as deserving of full and fair access to the administrative process as an inventor with a great idea who seeks a patent. And in many instances, that access comes from or in the form of an attorney or representative who is highly trained in the subject matter at issue and the processes of the agencies they appear before. I'm now pleased to hand over the Zoom microphone to LSC's partner in this webinar series, Andy Foyce, Chair of the Administrative Conference of the United States, who will offer additional words of welcome and background for the program. Welcome, Andy.
Thank you very much, Ron. And I must start off by saying I'm jealous of your flag in the background. I don't have a flag. I have the seal of the agency, but I've got to get myself a flag. And thank you, Ron, for LSC's collaboration on this project. You've been great partners. Thank you to today's panel, and thank you to everyone who has joined us today for the discussion. The Administrative Conference of the United States, how it is usually referred to by its acronym of ACUS, is an independent executive branch agency whose mission statement is simply to help government work better. To do that, ACUS helps federal agencies, assisted by outside experts, work together to study mutual problems, exchange information, and develop recommendations to improve administrative procedures. Since we opened for business in 1968, ACUS has raised or has issued almost 300 recommendations to agencies, the President, Congress, and the Judicial Conference, many of which have resulted in significant reforms. ACUS's defining feature is its organization. It's also its key to success. Recommendations are developed by more than 200 government officials, scholars, and practitioners, all of whom volunteer their time and expertise. Everyone works collaboratively to develop evidence-based, consensus-driven recommendations to improve administrative procedures. Administrative adjudication specifically is the subject of at least a third of our recommendations and other resources that we provide. Those recommendations address diverse topics ranging from hearing and appellate procedures to transparency and electronic case management. Now, I think we may all realize that when people think about access to justice issues, they don't usually think of agency adjudication and administrative processes, but it's through agency action, not just traditional litigation, that people must often seek critical benefits and services. They must navigate these agency procedures to do things like access business and educational opportunities, achieve environmental justice, secure redress for themselves or their communities for violations of their rights, and to avoid legal consequences, adverse legal consequences, and secure other outcomes. For these processes to be fair and equitable, and to ensure they yield accurate outcomes, parties often need support. Through this series, ACUS and LSC are examining ways the public and private sectors can help parties access the support they need navigating agency procedures. This is, of course, especially vital, as Ron says, for low-income people who may not be able to afford representation, as well as members of marginalized, vulnerable, and historically underserved communities. The first panel in December explored strategies for expanding access to representation in administrative procedures, mostly by lawyers, especially legal aid and pro bono service providers. But we know that there just aren't enough lawyers available to represent all those who need them. Almost 40 years ago, ACUS examined whether agencies could expand access to representation by permitting qualified non-lawyers to represent parties in proceedings before them. ACUS urged agencies to encourage and eliminate inappropriate barriers to non-lawyer assistance and representation. Today, however, we still face many of the same challenges. Once again this year, ACUS is proud to be part of the White House Legal and Interagency Roundtable, known also by its acronym of LAIR, which also includes LSC. And it is able to re-examine opportunities to promote access to justice across the government through qualified non-lawyer representation. qualified representation is the subject of ongoing ACUS work to assess the rules governing the participation and conduct of representatives in agency adjudication. We recently urged agencies to ensure that their rules governing representative conduct promote accessibility, fairness, integrity, and efficiency. ACUS has also convened a working group of representatives from the public and private institutions and sectors, including LSC once again, to develop model rules that agencies can use to improve their practices. And ACUS continues to examine ways agencies can better support self-represented parties, the subject of our next panel in June. ACUS has recommended such methods as developing self-help guides and institutionalizing online tools and digital processes. ACUS has also recommended best practices to ensure the fair, accurate, and accessible implementation of online chatbots. ACUS has co-led a working group on this important topic with the Justice Department's Office for Access to Justice. Agency representatives shared best practices and expressed interest in supporting self-represented parties. That initiative yielded recommendations on resourcing, data collection, coordination, and future considerations. Advancing equity, supporting underserved communities, and improving customer service in federal agencies continues to demand whole of government action. And to that end, LAIR also recently issued a report providing a roadmap for people-centered simplification of government forms, processes, and language. Today's panel, as Ron foreshadowed, will provide examples of how agencies and advocates can work together to promote effective representation before administrative agencies. ACUS has consistently encouraged agencies to engage with and solicit feedback from such representatives to ensure proceedings are fair and the parties are receiving the support that they need. I look forward to learning more from today's panelists about lessons learned and promising best practices. Much work remains to be done, of course, and that work will be informed by this series. Thank you for your attention. Now let me turn the program over to Stephanie Davis, the Senior Associate General Counsel at LSC, who will be moderating today's panel discussion. Stephanie?
Thank you, Andy and Ron, for setting the stage for today's discussion. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. As Ron and Andy said, today is the second in a series of four webinars exploring access to justice in federal agency proceedings. Our topic, promoting effective representation, builds on the lessons learned in our first webinar on expanding access to representation. That panel highlighted several strategies for expanding access, including disseminating information about the availability of legal assistance through community organizations and agency channels, using trained non-lawyer advocates and increasing the resources available to support attorneys and non-lawyer advocates who want to represent people in administrative proceedings. They also identified educational and cultural barriers to obtaining representation. These barriers included limited English proficiency, the likelihood of re-traumatization when a person seeking benefits must tell their story repeatedly to different people, distrust of government institutions, and a lack of advocates versed in the law and procedures of the programs through which people are seeking benefits. We won't be able to break down all of these barriers today. I hope that by the end of this discussion, you'll have a better understanding of the work that legal aid organizations and federal government agencies are doing to ensure that people seeking federal benefits and opportunities have quality representation available to them. We're very excited to have this group of experts share their knowledge, spanning federal benefits from income support to immigration to protection of intellectual property with you. They are Kristen Dama, Managing Attorney of the SSI Unit and Medical Legal Partnership at Community Legal Services of Philadelphia, Janet Gongola, the Vice Chief Judge for Engagement at the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, Lauren Alder Reed, the Assistant Director of the Office of Policy at the Executive Office for Immigration Review within the U.S. Department of Justice. And Robin Smith, Senior Attorney of the Economic Stability Group at the Legal Aid Foundation of Los Angeles, and also of counsel at the National Consumer Law Center. We've provided a link to their full bios in the chat. If you have questions as we proceed throughout today's discussion, please enter them to the chat. We're going to leave time for questions at the end and begin with our panel. We're very excited to hear from. So our first webinar in December, as I mentioned, explored barriers preventing individuals from accessing representation in federal administrative proceedings and overcoming these barriers, or strategies for overcoming these barriers. Our speakers all agreed that expanding access to representation would positively benefit both clients and the federal agencies involved in the proceedings. However, simply having a lawyer or an advocate isn't necessarily helpful in and of itself if the representative is not effective. As we start our discussion on strategies for providing effective representation, I'd like to start by asking you all to provide a bit of background about your organizations and the work that you do, your role in federal administrative proceedings, and most relevantly, what does effective representation look like in the types of cases that you work on? Kristen, would you like to get us started?
Sure. Thank you all so much for having me. My name is Kristen Dalma, as Stephanie said, I work at Community Legal Services, which is actually not an LSC program. We're a little bit of a weird place in that respect, but we are the large civil legal aid organization in Philadelphia that does high volume SSI work. We do about 1,100 cases per year at all ranges of engagement, from application to appeals to post-eligibility issues like overpayments or asset issues. We also connect our clients' lived experiences to policy in both the administrative and legislative arenas. So really, really excited to be here and to talk a little bit about the work that we do. Go ahead. I'm sorry, I'm getting...
No, you're fine. Can you reflect a little on what effective representation looks like?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think it's a really complicated question. And I think one of my favorite things about practicing in the administrative world is that it's not a zero-sum game, right? It's not inherently adversarial. And if we, those of us who do this work a lot in all kinds of administrative settings, get to know the people that we're working with on the other side. And I think that there's a fine line between, you know, making sure that we're not missing opportunities to hold agencies accountable, but at the same time, we can build trust, build relationships, and build an opportunity to kind of really make sure our clients get good outcomes in ways that feel win-win, where we're all sort of working for the administrative justice together. And I think the other piece that's really important about these cases is that, you know, we do income support work. Income is life-changing for people. And the people that we represent often have very significant trauma, very significant behavioral health impairments. For them, no matter how comfortable we as lawyers are in the agency setting, these processes are often very upsetting. They're very re-traumatizing. They can feel very dehumanizing. For disability cases, it can feel like people have to sort of perform their disabilities in ways that are just like not great. And so having us be involved, especially in a trauma-informed way, in a holistic representation way, which is our model, it does allow us to make that process feel a little less terrible and make people feel like they have someone on their side, which sometimes I think, regardless of outcome, is valuable in and of itself.
No, that's great. That is a wonderful answer and a great perspective. Janet, I'd love to hear your perspective from your very different side of the universe.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I too am very pleased to be here and thank LSC and ACUS for putting on this program and including the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office today. I'm the Vice Chief Judge for Strategy at the Patent Trial and Appeal Board. So I want to start off by explaining what that entity is. When a patent applicant does not get a patent, they're denied a patent by an examiner, they have the option of seeking review of that examiner's decision by the Patent Trial and Appeal Board. That's the first type of proceeding we adjudicate, and those are called ex parte appeals. The second type of proceeding we adjudicate is when a third party non-patent owner challenges the validity of a patent. So we will conduct inter-parties proceedings between the third party and the patent owner to determine whether the patent is valid. So now that you have that little bit of context about what we do at the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, I want to go to the concept of effective advocacy. For us, effective advocacy means understanding what the issues are in the case, having all of the relevant facts in front of us, and having an informed conversation about those issues as they pertain to the facts so that our administrative tribunal can reach the right result. So for us, we're not concerned if the person advocating is the senior-most counsel or the junior-most counsel. We want to make sure that whoever engages with us through briefing or oral argument knows the law, knows the facts, and can have that discussion so that it will aid us in making the right decision.
Thank you, Janet. Switching back to the legal aid side of the house for a second, Robin.
Hey, everybody. My name is Robin Smith again, senior attorney at the Legal Aid Foundation of Los Angeles. LAFLA has been doing student loan work consistently and is the only legal aid organization nationwide that has been doing this consistently for over 30 years. And so we've built a very deep expertise in student loan law, which is all that I practice at Legal Aid. I and another attorney are solely devoted to doing student loan work at Legal Aid. And really think it's very important for other legal aides to take a look at getting involved in these issues. To have effective representation for student loans issues, I think obviously the people who are practicing need to be familiar with this complex area of laws, and be able to accurately assess a client's options and obtain the data necessary to do so, which is not easy to do. You have to get data from the Department of Education. I think the second thing is to understand when to give what is the appropriate level of representation, whether it's CNA counsel and advice or something higher, depending on the needs of the client and what the issues are in the case. We have such a high demand for our services because there is so little availability for student loan assistance that we really have to triage sometimes and figure out sort of what levels of services we're giving different clients. And that can be very hard to figure out. I think another really important part of the work we do is systemic advocacy, meaning we keep an eye on the issues that pop up in our cases and for issues that may be system-wide so that we can have a bigger impact on the Department of Education's administration of its programs. And also we work nationwide with other legal aides, the National Consumer Law Center, to coordinate the work we do to watch for trends. And just as one example, right now, we're working with a small coalition of legal aides on language access issues and pushing the Department of Education to translate their forms and all of their information into Spanish. And we've been effective in starting to get that rolling. So that's really something we've been working on for a very long time, and it's finally happening. So we're really happy. The last thing I think is to have effective representation, you need creativity, right? So you don't always have to use the formal administrative process to resolve issues. Sometimes, for example, Department of Education has an ombudsman's office, which can be very helpful in going to for assistance, but also think outside the box. Maybe you go to your client's congressperson or senator to get help. There are other ways to resolve issues outside of the formal administrative process. And I think effective representation means thinking through all of the different avenues to obtaining a good outcome for your client.
Excellent. Thank you, Robin. And Lauren.
Hi, good afternoon, morning where you are. I will be very fortunate of having gone after the three illustrious panelists who have spoken before me, because I think they covered so much of the important ground of effective representation. I will get there in a second. The Executive Office for Immigration Review, EOIR, or EOIR, some of you may know, is often just referred to as the Immigration Courts. We also have the Board of Immigration Appeals and the Office of the Chief Administrative Hearing Officer, all of which hear cases related to immigration. So immigration proceedings that are filed before our agency by DHS through a variety of ways end up in the immigration courts. Appeals go to the BIA, and then OCAHO is a separate process with specific employment-related cases. So labor-related cases. Effective representation, echoing so much of what those before me have said, definitely an understanding of the proceedings themselves. Immigration is an incredibly complex area of law. So also understanding that the laws, regulations, and case precedents that may apply. And being able to be a zealous advocate for their client. Also understanding, much like Robin said, thinking outside of the box. So a great example right now for us is pre-hearing conferences. For those of you who practice, that may sound like an obvious thing, but pre-hearing conferences are something we're really looking for folks to engage and find stipulations and things of that nature with the Department of Homeland Security, who is on the other side from the respondents, non-citizen respondents. So just echoing all of those things and ultimately seeking true justice.
Excellent. Thank you for painting that picture from both sides about what effective representation looks like. They are different perspectives. But you know, the common theme that I'm hearing is being able to truly present someone's case with as many facts as possible, with as good a record as possible. That's a value that representatives can bring to the table, whether they're attorneys or properly trained non-attorney advocates. So going to that point, now that we've learned about what you consider to be effective representation in the proceedings that you're familiar with, how do we, how do you, how do organizations and agencies doing this work, what advice or what practices do you use for training attorneys and training non-lawyer advocates to provide that level of representation? Janet, I'll start with you.
The Patent Trial and Appeal Board has a specific training program called LEAP, or Legal Experience and Advancement Program. So we use LEAP to incentivize parties to allow less experienced practitioners to have the opportunity to stand up, make arguments in our court proceedings. Oftentimes for less experienced advocates, it's very, very difficult for them to get that first stand-up opportunity, but the first time they get it, it can lead to the second, to the third, to the fourth. It makes them more comfortable and more effective in their future advocacy. So in exchange for a party allowing a less experienced attorney to make argument, we give the party 15 minutes of extra argument time. We've been running this program for 2.5 years, and it is increasingly popular. We've had over 250 less experienced practitioners appear in real cases. But we don't stop there. To help the less experienced practitioners prepare so that they're comfortable appearing, they have advocacy skills, they know what to expect, we have a training program, and it's multifaceted. One aspect of the training program is we will have experienced litigators work with junior attorneys to sort of teach them the ropes, teach them how to prepare for an argument in advance, how to handle the pressure of an argument on the actual day, how to handle the judge questions. We then give the less experienced attorneys a practice opportunity. They will do a mock argument simulating a real case in front of a 3-judge panel. At the conclusion of that practice session, the judges give one-on-one feedback, good and for improvement, to the new practitioner. That way they're kind of being coached and developing their argumentation skills. And then finally, we have a program where the less experienced counsel come to our court. They get a behind the scenes opportunity to see our hearing facilities. The tours, if you will, are conducted by judges. The judges show them, this is where the counsel stands. This is what the courtroom looks like. Here's what you're gonna see on all the screens. Here's where the demonstratives will appear. They also allow the less experienced counsel to sit on the bench and view the proceeding from the judge vantage point so that they feel comfortable when it comes time to make that actual case. Now, we run this program now for less experienced licensed attorneys and patent agents. We are starting to expand the program this year to cover law students and those who are not registered to practice before the office or licensed attorneys, because inventors can represent themselves in these proceedings, and we want to arm them, in addition to counsel, with the best advocacy skills possible.
That's fantastic. And I love that you're reaching beyond the licensed attorney population to give this knowledge and to share that experience in practicing. Robin, what are you doing either with LAFLA or with the National Consumer Law Center in the student debt area?
Yes. So we, you know, encourage people. NCLC has an annual conference and always has a student loan track. So we encourage people to go to that conference, both to get the student loan training and to meet other legal aid attorneys that are practicing in the area. We also encourage and hope that that legal aides who are practicing in this area have pay for it. And unfortunately you have to pay for it, but there's an NCLC student loan manual that's really key. Because there aren't trainings available around the clock, a lot of attorneys are going to have to just jump in and get started. And the manual, the NCLC manual, is really the way to get started and to learn things. However, NCLC and a group of legal aides in the country are now, we've started a project where every month we meet. We invite all the legal aides that want to participate to call in, and we do a short training on some area of interest, and then we open it up for questions, including questions about people's cases, if they want to brainstorm with us or they're stuck on a case and they want to sort of get everyone the expertise of other folks on the call. We do that every month. And we are also trying to team up mentorship programs so that new attorneys at legal aids can team up with another legal aid attorney somewhere in the country to have it as a person they can talk to, they can consult with, and they can get examples from, so that we really want to encourage more people to get into this, but it is a daunting area of law for sure. And then, of course, providing templates and samples so that when people are developing, for example, we don't do hearings. We do all of our administrative advocacy through documentation. And so helping people, for example, to learn how to write mini briefs, which are actually cover letters explaining all the evidence we're submitting to get someone an administrative discharge of their student loan. So providing examples of those kinds of mini briefs so that people know how to go ahead and draft those. So that's kind of a nut case. That's how we, in a nut case, provide training.
No, I love that. I love
that. And it's nutshell. Sorry, that's so not a nut case.
No worries. I love the idea of having mentors, of involving mentors and connecting people that way across organizations and strengthening the network of experienced practitioners. Kristen, what are you doing at CLS, which has a very long and storied Social Security income program?
Sure. Thanks. Thanks, Stephanie. I feel like one of the biggest plugs I want to make for the other legal aid practitioners out there is just an acknowledgement, first of all, that that we're all operating in very scarce resources, and that funding really matters, and that SSI cases and a lot of complex administrative cases can be really difficult to take on because they take a lot of staff resources. And I believe, you know, obviously from where I sit, that these are the core legal aid cases. The really income cases are so important. They make everything else, whether it's housing or medical, utility bills, everything else better. But they do require funding. And some of that requires, you know, kind of a dedicated commitment to identifying a funding stream to make these cases happen. And I think there's a real business case for these cases in that they prevent homelessness, or houselessness, they prevent reincarceration, they keep people connected to medical care, all of those good things. And so I think that, CLS has had a lot of success making that case to Pennsylvania to create a funding stream for SSI cases. I know there are a number of other states that where there is a dedicated funding stream. We've spent a lot of time thinking about how to talk about this to not just to government funders, but to other funders, and would be really happy, you know, if folks want to reach out to me. I'm happy to have my contact information in the chat. People can reach out to me. I'm happy to kind of talk and connect about how to do that. I think with that many, we've done a couple things that are I think, very important because these cases are complex. Mm-hmm. They require a lot of skill. You can't just kind of dabble in them and get the outcomes you want. One of them is to really focus on a holistic practice model that does include social work. I think non-attorney advocates, paralegals are really, really important. And then I think the other piece is to really really in some ways sort of professionalize our training model. You know, we have a very robust training model within CLS when you're onboarded. It's not like, you know, a college class or anything. We just sort of made it up, but we make sure that people get 2 solid months of training. And then we also do a lot of skills building across Pennsylvania, across like a learning community with our funding. And those are curriculum that I'm also really happy to share.
Excellent. Thank you, Kristen. And Lauren, what are y'all doing at DOJ?
Sure. I want to start by saying absolutely hear what Kristen is saying about the scarce resources and that lengthy cases can be really daunting and perhaps just not possible for some of the legal services out there. We recently published a rule that allows for limited appearances, and it can be anything from helping someone complete their forms or applications, you know, to individual pieces of, helping along in the process. There's also some other specific bond custody type hearings that people can appear for only those rather than taking on a full case. So for people out there who are interested, and I'll talk about how we'll help you get ready here in a second, there are opportunities for taking parts of cases if you don't have the time or other resources to dedicate to a full case. So what will we do to get you there? For starters, we've reinvigorated our model hearing program. We do offer it for individual organizations interested in providing a training for people associated with their organization, employees or volunteers in their community who want to learn how to work in immigration court or help someone who is. And we also have, as part of that, a web available model hearing program. So we do hold live model hearing program events online as well, and then have the on-demand session. So what is model hearing program? Well, we first teach the substantive law behind the mock record of proceeding that we provide and the mock fact pattern so that there's a base understanding of what the immigration law that applies to the mock case is. That can certainly help in future cases as well, different pieces of it for different types of cases. And then we show you how the hearing proceeds. The judge sits, the judge adjudicates, we have someone, you know, representing the DHS in the case, as well as the non-citizen respondent, witnesses, et cetera, all of whom, of course, are acting for the role. Those are available, as I said, on demand once we've done them live. And we're really excited to launch our second iteration of that model hearing program on demand and live series here in the next couple months. So stay tuned for that. We also watch for opportunities to engage with all of you who may be interested. Our recognition and accreditation program comes with it a requirement to have completed certain amounts of training and types of training to be a non-attorney representative before the agency. So it's something that we look at very closely to make sure that we can have that effective representation and that we can do what we can to help you get there. So I think that covers, did I answer everything there, Stephanie?
Yeah, I think so. It's again, sounds like a very holistic ground up program that both you and Janet at the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office have described. Agencies really starting at the root of law, the law, and then helping with giving practitioners guidance and practice with the actual proceedings and opportunities to engage in proceedings, which makes for better and more effective representation. I have a quick question regarding evaluating the effectiveness of the training programs that you do. Do any of you measure the effectiveness, or have you, you know, kind of how do you determine whether you need to make any changes to those programs? Janet, I'll start with you again.
Yes, we do measure the effectiveness of our programs. For all of, I call them leapers, the less experienced attorneys who participate, we have an evaluation form and we ask for their feedback. And much of the expansion of our LEAP program comes from the ideas of leapers. We initially did not have a behind the scenes sort of tour of the hearing facilities. One of the leapers suggested, hey, that would be a great idea. So we made the enhancement to the program. Another suggestion was to have an experienced counsel argue the same case that a leaper argues in a mock setting so that the leaper can compare notes with the way the experienced counsel handled themselves, asked the experienced counsel questions. So we added that feature to the program. And we're continually evolving the program based upon the input of the public as to what they want to see and what is working for them.
Great. Lauren, Kristen, Robin, do your programs evaluate outcomes? Or seek, how do you seek input from participants on improving them?
I think for us, the best way we evaluate outcomes is hearing from the participants, much like Janet was talking about. We're very fortunate that our stakeholders are forthcoming with their feedback and let us know when they have found things to be helpful or maybe things that have areas where we can improve. And we certainly take that feedback. It's so valuable. To try to incorporate into future iterations. The model hearing program is a great example in hearing feedback from individuals who either participated in a live event or viewed it on demand. We've learned that there were some tweaks that we could make in order to make it more accessible in the broad sense for all involved, you know, at the live and the webcast to make it more engaging regardless of the format. Also, I think one thing we see that helps us know how we're doing is watching numbers. We really are trying to engage, build capacity in our recognition and accreditation program for non-lawyers to represent, as well as a national effort to build the pro bono base, with the understanding, of course, that resources are scarce for the organizations and they only have so many hours and so many cases. We do think our limited appearances rule is really going to help with that. And we'll be watching closely to see if we're right.
All right.
And then for us, and because again, we live in a resource scarce environment, we spend a lot of time tracking our success rates at all levels of the process to see how where our outcomes where we are making the most impact, so we can kind of allocate our resources and our case acceptance that way. So we represent clients at the reconsideration stage, which is a paper first level review. And in those cases, we aren't having a lot of impact because it takes a long time for us to get on. And in the hearing stage, the national win rate is between 40 and 45%. And our win rate is about 60%. So we're beating the national win rate by about 20%, which very proud of, because we take hard to win cases. And so that's where we're putting a lot of resources, because we can really see that we're having that impact. The other place where we do a lot, we track outcomes, is in those dollar amounts that we get for clients. And that is, to kind of connect my previous answer, really important in that funding conversation. In Pennsylvania, all of our partner programs in the state collect our dollar amounts. And what we've seen is that for every dollar in legal aid spending, we can put $7 and $8 in our clients' pockets. And so that's a huge return on investment for these cases. And it really allows us, as I was saying earlier, and this is like the managing attorney hat, right? That makes us, lets us make that business case to Pennsylvania and to others, that even though these cases take a lot of time, they are a really good deal. Or when you look at kind of the strain on social services that we're alleviating.
Yes. Yes. Completely agree.
And I'll just briefly mention, we do also track our outcomes and use data to do that. One of the problems we've noticed is that student loan data isn't required to be tracked separately as a separate category for LSC or other purposes. So we have really built out our own data capacity in the last year to track student loan outcomes, as well as sort of what were our clients suffering before they came to us, and sort of to have a better picture of really what are the student loan issues and how are we helping people and what are the financial outcomes for those folks. So we've really thought hard about that and built out our own system so that we can report and track that information.
Okay. Perfect. That's great. Excellent. So how do we bring more people to the table? What are your strategies for recruiting new lawyers and non-lawyer advocates to develop this specialized training? Because one of the commonalities I think you all raised is that the types of issues that you're working on, even though the process itself is not set up to be an adversarial process, the law is complex. The procedures themselves may be a little bit complex. So how do you recruit people and bring them into the table? Lauren, I'll start with you.
Sure. And I got into this a little bit in my last answer of looking to engage stakeholders at all levels, the private bar, non-governmental organizations, law school clinics, anywhere we can find interested parties. So again, with the recognition and accreditation program, we're looking at non-attorneys, people who can show that they have the support and the training that would make it appropriate for them to serve as effective representatives in immigration court. I should note as well that accreditation, it has a partial and a full, and the partial accreditation actually allows the individuals to represent folks before DHS, so in their proceedings, and then full accreditation allows both DHS and before EOIR. So that's an important distinction to make also if someone's thinking about the types of cases they might be interested in taking. In addition, we have a pro bono legal service provider list, and that list is actually provided to every respondent who comes into immigration court. It is a localized list, and then the full list is available online, so you can see nationwide how many individuals and organizations or referral services are available to help people connect with pro bono organizations. The MHP, the model hearing program that I mentioned before, is certainly a training mechanism that we are hoping to continue to expand and are really excited about getting more people involved. That's it for me.
Okay. Others? Kristen, do you want to jump in?
Yeah, sure. So I love this question because uh, I it's very interesting having worked in locally involved for a long time. You know, different issues are trendy or sexy at a different time. You know, I also manage our medical legal partnerships, and lots and lots of people are applying for medical legal partnership jobs. Fewer people are going to law school to do SSI work. And so I think what has been really important for recruitment, retention, just generally being excited about our jobs, is to really think about what it means, right? What and what this work is. And what it is, I mean, this is, like I said this earlier, but like the core of justice work, right? Income affects everything. Putting money in people's pockets is like the intrinsic way that you solve poverty. There's lots and lots of growing bodies of data around this. And so I think really sort of putting that mission into action and really articulating that mission, and also recognizing that we are this work, income programs, part of the reason people don't want to do income work is because it's been very much racialized, very much demonized, very much kind of beat up in the press and everywhere else. And people really struggle with that idea of just giving people money and solving problems and having people have self-determination. And so we are very much aligned with disability justice work and very much aligned with racial justice work. It's been really important for us to name that and to partner with groups who are doing that great work and also unpack our own biases. And I have found that kind of spirit and that energy of really kind of grounding our work in other movements and naming where it fits has created a lot of great energy, both in terms of recruitment and then also of retention.
Thank you. Janet?
So for our LEAP program, we have a few different ways in which we're trying to circulate word about the program into the community. We maintain a web page, www.uspto.gov/LEAP. You can find all kinds of information about the program there. We also hold every 2 years a recognition ceremony for those who have participated, both the LEAPers and their sponsoring employers. So that way, if someone is looking for counsel, they can go on the website, they can see who's participated in the program and therefore has a minimum level of experience as an effective advocate in front of the board. We love to talk about the LEAP program at every speaking opportunity, just like today, that we can get, and we ask others to help tell their colleagues, their peers, about the program so the information really gets spread across the community. And then lastly, every hearing order that the Patent Trial and Appeal Board issues has information about the availability of the LEAP program in it. That way, those who are going to be arguing are aware of the program, and they may give the opportunity to argue to a less experienced practitioner.
Great, thank you. And Robin.
I'll be quick. I'll just say I agree with Kristen that, you know, we present this as a racial justice and civil rights issue. Equal access to higher education is so incredibly important for achieving racial justice. And the Higher Education Act, although it was enacted to ensure that everyone has access to affordable, quality higher education, has largely failed on that front in a lot of ways. And so it's really critical for us to be removing the barriers posed by debt, both to achieving higher education for the folks that really want to get it, and also for income stability purposes. And so we present it to prospective students who also don't go to law school thinking, I'm going to do student loan work. The law clerks who work for us are always shocked at how interesting and how much work it is. And so we really try to pitch it as a really interesting civil rights, economic justice type of work, and are able to recruit people that way.
That's great. Thank you, Robin. I really loved hearing about how you reframe this, how you reframe the work as social justice, reducing inequalities work, because that is the lens that we're looking at, and that, you know, that is an access to justice issue, that's an access to justice issue. We hear about it most often in the courts, but the reason that we're doing this webinar series is because those are also issues that people face in administrative proceedings. We're coming to the end of our time together, but I just wanted to ask a quick question about pro bono, and I'll just throw it open to any of you. I guess primarily Robin and Kristen, because you have your staffs, but then you also try to build on your resources by reaching outside to find private attorneys who can assist you with these cases. So can you kind of talk about the work that you do to bring pro bono attorneys in, or the opportunities to bring pro bono attorneys in?
I can say we don't have a lot of success doing that. It's very okay. difficult in public. I've been trying for a long time to think about how to do this, but it's difficult when you have such a complex area mm-hmm. and very long cases with very long lifespans.
Okay.
Yeah, I would say that that's been our experience as well. I feel like where we've been more successful is building some pretty meaningful partnerships around resource allocation. And what I mean by that is, the Social Security Bar is actually very robust, and there's some very high quality yep. representatives, and their business model looks really different than the legal aid model. And so having a really open line of communication about what are the cases that, you know, for better work, there's a market for. And then we've been really intentional about trying to fill the gaps so that we're mm-hmm. not, so that we're having as much of a reach as possible and as many people get lawyers as possible.
Okay, great. And Lauren, did you have a comment?
I think I would just repeat myself at this point. Happy to do okay. so, but.
not at all happy to do that, but we did get a follow-up question that is for Kristen, and I think is relevant to the question of filling gaps. This is from a legal aid attorney in Louisiana who manages a unit of six attorneys who take referrals from six different medical legal partnerships and three different homeless shelters in the city. And her question is, do you do initial applications for people who need SSI or SSDI? Who do you have work on those, attorneys or non-attorneys? And do you use the SOAR method for filing new applications for your clients who are unhoused? So it's a very technical question.
Yeah. So the SOAR model, for folks who don't practice in this world, is sort of an expedited special handling unit within Social Security that has community partners all over the country doing kind of fast track applications to prevent or address houselessness. And it's like the gold standard for SSI application. And in my policy hat, I spend a lot of time working with advocates fighting to kind of expand it beyond the homeless advocacy world, and move it, because it is so effective to getting people on SSI, and we are so far not successful, but we're going to keep working. We are not a SOAR provider. Our partner, Homeless Advocacy Project, is. They do an amazing job. And we do applications sort of in constant contact with them about like what's a SOAR case, because we get as many people on that way fast. And then what is not a SOAR case, so we fill in the gaps kind of in that resource allocation lens that I was just talking about. Our model to do applications is that we have a supervising attorney, and then sort of the most of the client facing work is handled by non-attorney staff, by parents.
Great, thank you. We are just about at our time. This has been a fascinating discussion. I want to thank you all once again for joining us and for highlighting some of the issues that you have and providing us with some really valuable thoughts. Again, the value of having a representative who can build the best record for the adjudicatory body to consider, thinking creatively about all of the ways in which you can advocate for your client, whether that's through the formal adjudicative process or talking to ombuds people or doing pre-hearing conferences, as Laura mentioned. And then, of course, the importance of mentorship, having people who have been there to bring the younger attorneys along. In the couple minutes that we have left, I'd like to ask you each for one key takeaway. If there's only one thing that our audience walks away learning from you, what is that takeaway? And Robin, I'll start with you.
Sure. My takeaway is if legal aides can try to figure out a way to do student loan work, do it. It's if people have defaulted student loans, they face wage garnishment, the garnishment of their Social Security or SSDI benefits, as well as tax refund offsets, including their earned income tax credit. And so it is so important to do this work to prevent those. And also in legal aid, we team up. I'm in the public benefits division because this is such a key income stability issue. So I really hope people will consider expanding into the student loan area.
Thank you. Lauren?
Thank you, Stephanie. Our takeaway would be we would love to have you. We are working to give the resources we can to help everyone feel comfortable in our proceedings, and we welcome feedback on what we can do better and more. We have pro bono committees around the country in our immigration courts themselves to help support building of the pro bono capacity, as well as looking to find those individuals associated with some of the legal services organizations that are looking to become accredited representatives for that appearance before USCIS or before EOIR. And we hope that you'll tune in for our model hearing program and reach out if you're interested. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Kristen?
I feel like, without repeating anything else I've said, I guess the one thing I'll say is that these cases, as we've said, are complicated and they're hard. And I know that some people are kind of in small offices doing them on their own. You don't have to be alone. There's a very robust national network of advocates like us. And if you are not hooked up with that network of that's like sharing ideas and bouncing ideas off each other and, you know, kind of escalating things to Baltimore to get problems solved, please reach out to me. I think they were going to share my email address. I would love to kind of connect you with our network so that you have some support.
Wonderful. Thank you, Kristen. And Janet, closing out with you.
My words are a quote from Mahatma Gandhi. He said in 1913, to be the change that you want to see in the world. That is how the LEAP program came into existence. We wanted to see a change by enabling and equipping our junior practitioners to be more effective, to have more opportunities. So whether it is in the student loan, the immigration, the SSI world, if there's a change you want to see, I think the idea is that we need to act first and make that change happen so that we can have a great world for the next generation.
Great. Thank you, Janet. I, again, really can't thank you all enough for participating today. We've learned so much from you. We will be able to share. We will follow up with people who asked questions. We're sorry we couldn't get to them all. And we'll be able to share email addresses with people who asked for them. I want to remind everyone that we have the third installment of this webinar series, which is centered on resources for self-represented parties in administrative proceedings on June 27th. That will also be at 1 p.m. Eastern Time. You can register for that session already. Thank you again for joining us, and have a great day.